So, hear me, everything is okay? Do you hear me at the back? Okay. So I'm going to talk about systems with long-range interactions. There's a lot of literature on this, and I'm not going to give you a list of, you know, a long list of references, but there is a recent book where you can find a lot of things on this subject. It's called Physics of Long Range Interacting Systems. This is by Kampa, Doxoise, Fanelli, Riri, and Ruffo. This is Oxford, 2014. This is a book where you can find a lot of references of things I'm going to talk about. There's also lecture notes, which I put on the web some time ago. So I'll give you the reference. It's on archive. I don't have it right here, but okay. I'll give it to you later. Where some of the material I'm going to talk about is covered there. Okay. So let me start by what do I mean by systems with long-range interactions? Let's think of a system where you have two body interactions, where the potential V of R scales as 1 over R to some power. And usually this is written as R to the power D plus sigma, where D is a dimension. Usually in statistical physics, we deal with systems with short-range interactions, either just nearest neighbors or nearest neighbor or some local environment, or interactions that decays exponentially with the distance. Then all the rules that we know, the simple rules of statistical physics, apply there. Here we're talking about a system where the interaction decays algebraically. And in particular, we'll be interested in systems where sigma is negative. That is, the power law, the decay, is slower than the dimension of the system. So in three dimensions, it should decay slower than 1 over r cubed. Okay? Now, the main feature of such systems, if sigma is negative, is that such systems are not additive, as we expect in usual systems with short-range interactions. Namely, if you look at the energy, suppose you have some sphere or some with homogeneously distributed particles which interact with this kind of interaction, then the total energy is just, you just have to integrate over all the energies. And therefore, if you integrate over, say, if you take one particle in the middle of the sphere and it interacts with 1 over r to the power d plus sigma, dr. You take one particle and you ask, what is the interaction with all other particles? You have to do this integral, right? And then you have to integrate over all other particles with their interactions. That will contribute another factor of V. V is the volume of the system, basically, the number of particles. So if you do this integral, then it's clear that this goes up to some radius R. So if the system is some radius R, some from 1 to some short distance cutoff to some distance r, this goes like v to the power r to the power minus sigma. Right? Just do scaling, right? Here you have d, the d cancels with that, and then there is r to the power minus sigma. Which means that it goes like if V to the power 1 minus sigma over D, right? R is V to the power 1 over D. Now, if sigma is negative, it means that the energy, the total energy of such a body, scales not linearly with volume, as we expect in usual systems that in statistical physics that we deal with, but they scale with a higher power than the size of the system, than the volume of the system. And as a result of this, a lot of the properties that we are all used to in statistical physics are not going to apply, and we have to do something else. Okay? So this is basically the problem that comes when you have interactions with a power law like that. Okay. Now there are many examples of such systems. Okay. Okay, clearly gravitational systems. Okay, self-gravitating systems. Where the potential goes like 1 over r, and sigma is equal to minus 2. Okay? Okay? And there are plenty of systems. I'll discuss it a little bit later. There are globular clusters. For example, there are clusters of stars. These are systems where you can have aggregation of, say, 100,000 stars which occupy some finite region in space, and they behave like a cloud, and they interact, of course, in this way. And there are a lot of features that I will discuss later on that would come out because of these long-range interactions there. Okay. But there are many other examples. For example, if you take dipolar magnets. Okay, here, well, you know that if you have dipole-dipole interaction, the interaction goes like V of r, roughly like 1 over r cubed, right? That's with the distance. It's anisotropic, but it decays like 1 over r cubed. Now, this is a case where sigma is equal to 0. Right? It's on the borderline between short and long-range interactions. But it turns out that even there, when sigma is equal to 0, you can have features which are characteristic of long-range interactions. So that the borderline is also a case which falls into this category. Okay, for example, you can think of course, plasmas. You know, electric interaction, you know, Coulomb interaction between potentials. There is the issue of you can have screening because you have positive charges and negative charges. But if you have charged plasmas, then clearly they have this kind of interaction and things are there. The other example. For example, you can think of vortices in two dimensions. If you have vortices, they're all kind of. Okay. Vortices interact by. Interaction which goes like log of r. It's a logarithmic interaction. So basically, since we are talking about log of r is basically sigma is equal to 0, that's roughly non-decaying, and therefore it's again a case of sigma is equal to minus 2 if we're talking about in two dimensions. Okay? So there are plenty of examples. Of systems which, for which this feature is there, they are not additive, and you have to look how to treat them in statistical physics in order to study their properties. Okay. What is the main problem that arises when you have this non-additivity or non-extensivity? If you look at the free energy of a system, you know the free energy is composed of two parts, is the energy minus temperature times the entropy, right? That's the, please ask me and stop me whenever if there's any problem that I need to explain. Now, typically, in systems with short-range interactions, where systems are additive, both the energy scales like the volume or number of particles, or, you know, they scale with the size of the system. And the entropy also scales like the volume. And so they have, in the thermodynamic limit, when the volume is large, they are comparable. And therefore, you can have competition between entropy and energy depending on the temperature, right? So they can compete. And therefore, you can have interesting effects that arise from this competition between energy and entropy. And this could give rise to phase transitions, to all kinds of problems. Yes?
When sigma is greater than zero.
Sorry?
Sigma is greater than zero. Sigma?
Right?
Then it doesn't scale as V, right?
No. If sigma is larger than zero, here. Yeah, of course, because you have to be careful. This goes like a constant. This integral becomes a constant. If sigma is positive, okay? The leading term is a constant. If you want, it's this plus a constant. And when sigma is positive, this goes to zero, and you end up with a constant. But if sigma is negative, the leading part is this, and therefore you can drop off the constant. Good. Okay. Okay. Now, they both scale like the volume. And therefore, in the usual case, in systems with short-range interactions, they have there is a balance between the two, and a lot of interesting things can come up with this competition. Now, here, in systems with long-range interactions, these scales, the energy scales like 1 minus sigma over d, which is a higher power than the volume or the number of particles, if sigma is negative. On the other hand, entropy, you don't expect it to scale like more than the volume, right? Because what is entropy? I mean, you have particles, and you distribute them all around. And the number of states that you have typically is exponentially in the volume, because, you know, just it's exponentially in the volume. And therefore, when you take the log to calculate the entropy, you get a volume. That's OK. And therefore, in such systems, the energy is much, much larger than the entropy. And you would have thought there's nothing interesting happening there in such systems, because at least if the system is large enough in the thermodynamic limit, entropy is negligibly small. And OK, so you have an energy, and whatever the energy is, that's what you have for the system. Now, while this is true, still a lot of interesting things can happen, because you can think of a finite system. Okay, in a finite system, and when the temperature is sufficiently high, you can still make these two terms comparable to each other. And you can have, this competition can give rise to a lot of interesting phenomena that characterize these systems. Okay. That's basically where things can show up. Okay. Okay. So let me just, for example, just to demonstrate that this can happen, let's look at the some structure of globular structures. Globular okay. Okay. Or basically globular clusters. So these are clusters of stars that I mentioned before. So let's just make an estimate of entropy versus energy for this kind of systems to see what does it look like. So such systems, as I said, if you take a particular system, if you have it's a number of stars, which is about 150,000 stars, which exist in a region in space which is roughly 175 light years. Okay, so there are, okay, as the mass of each one of them, say, if you take a solar mass, is roughly 2 times 10 to the 30 kilograms. Okay, what is the energy? The energy is just G, the gravitational constant, times n squared, times m squared over r. Right? That's just the potential energy of gravitational energy associated with a body like that. The entropy, on the other hand, is, say, roughly K Boltzmann times n number of particles, times some function of the density, but let's just look at it as an order of magnitude. If you look at E over S, and you put these numbers, you find that it's about 10 to the 61 degrees Kelvin. So that just from the, okay. Now, if you ask what should be the temperature of such a gas, you can look at it as a gas of particles which are moving around. What should be the temperature of such a gas so that it would be comparable to that, so that E over TS will be one, of order one, that they will be comparable to each other. So if you think about it, what is the temperature? The temperature is the kinetic energy of each particle, right? 1/2 K Boltzmann T is 1 over 6 M V squared, right? Roughly, the V is velocity. If you ask for temperature, which is of this order, and for mass, which is of this order, what is the velocity that this star should move around, it goes like V goes like 10 kilometers per second, which is very reasonable in such systems. So you see that you can have cases where the temperature is sufficiently high and the system is confined to some in some region in space where this becomes comparable, and you can have competition between the two, and you can still use the notion of free energy to study this kind of thing. Okay. 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 Okay, but in general, this is just an example, and let's look at. Okay, let me take it out. Take this out. Okay. Okay. Now, to deal with this, you want to write down a Hamiltonian of the system, and you want to study the statistical mechanics of this. Then you say that let's take the Hamiltonian of the system. of a system which interacts with this kind of interaction and rescale it. That is, rescale it by volume to the power 1 minus sigma over d, sorry. OK? In that case, since the Hamiltonian, as we say, the energy scales like the volume to the power 1 minus sigma over d, if we just rescale the Hamiltonian just artificially, then this would scale like the volume. And then when you look at the rescaled Hamiltonian and you look at the energy, at the free energy, which is E minus TS, then when you rescaling the Hamiltonian is basically equivalent to going to high temperature. Instead of going to high temperature, you can just rescale the Hamiltonian and study it this way. So this is the usual way one does this theoretical treatment of this system. You rescale the Hamiltonian with understanding that it's basically the same thing as looking at the system, at the real system, with long-range interaction. At high temperature. Okay. So such kind of rescaling appears very naturally when you look at dipolar systems, dipolar magnets. Okay? If you look at dipolar magnets, the potential the interaction is V of R. Between, suppose you have two dipoles at the distance r from each other, the interaction goes like Si times Sj divided by r cubed minus 3 times Si dot r Sj dot r divided by r to the fifth. This is dipole-dipole interaction, the usual dipole-dipole interaction, okay? Where r is the vector between the two spins. Now, actually, if you look at an ellipsoidal sample of dipoles which interact in this way, and suppose the magnet is, you have it's magnetized and the magnetization is homogeneous, you can show that the Hamiltonian of the system, you can express this dipole-dipole interaction in terms of the magnetization factor. That is, the Hamiltonian goes into the Hamiltonian. That's the short-range part. You have a short-range part. And this part is going to be translated into minus d over v times m squared. M is the magnetization. If you have some ellipsoid and it's magnetized, say, in some direction, then the energy of that system is whatever the energy of the short-range term. And the energy that comes from these dipole-dipole interactions can be expressed in this way. V is the volume. M is the magnetization. And D is called demagnetization factor, some number. And you see that this term is basically of this form here, because M is a magnetization, is an extensive quantity. It scales like the volume. It's as if I added a term to the Hamiltonian, which with energy that scales like the volume by dividing the energy by the volume. Okay? Now you know, sorry, question? Sorry? D is what's called the demagnetization factor. It's some demagnetization factor. And you all know from in your studies of electrodynamics that if you look at dipolar magnets, say ellipsoidal, the energy depends on the shape of the dipole, right? If you have a needle, that's one energy. If you have a sphere, that's a different energy. And if you have, a plate, a disk, that's a different energy. And of course, this means that the there is an effect of long-range interaction. Because in short-range interaction, the energy is never dependent on the shape of the sample. Because short-range, you know, the sample is just surface effect, and it doesn't cost anything. On the other hand, when you have interactions which are long-range, like here, which can be expressed in this way, this demagnetization factor it's basically a tensor. It depends on the orientation of the magnetization. It also depends on the shape. And that's a feature which comes with the long-range interaction. Okay? Just, so. Yes. Sorry?
Magnetization goes
with the volume. Yeah, it's a total magnetization.
Yeah. Then I see that the second term goes as volume.
Right.
So,
but it depends on the shape.
Okay.
And that's where the, you know, that's where it's, you know, all I'm saying, all I said was that it has this feature of basically you have this kind of rescaling appear there naturally. And since the energy depends on the shape, it's of the sample. It's a borderline between long range and short range. And
okay, so here, where does the shape dependence go? Does it go into the D?
Sorry. Well, this orientation is a tensor. For a given ellipsoid, it's a tensor which depends on the orientation of the magnetization, and of course it depends on the, you know, the eccentricity of this ellipsoid, whether it's a very long and very short, and that's why it, and there that's where it shows up. Okay. So this kind of energy. If we think, for example, of a magnetic system, for example, we can think of an Ising model. Okay. So you all know about Ising model, right? It's a model of spins, sigma I, which are either plus or minus 1. And we can take a Hamiltonian. Typically, it's minus j, some constant. Ij is the nearest neighbor coupling. And sigma I, sigma j, right? This is the Hamiltonian of the Ising model. You all familiar? No? OK, good. Then. Clearly, if J is positive, this Hamiltonian supports a ferromagnetic ordering, that is, all sigma as want to be aligned with each other. Now, suppose now we, instead of looking at this model, we look at a model where with long-range interaction, that is, suppose every spin interacts with every other spin. So, okay, so it's minus J, sum over sigma I goes from 1 to n squared. So basically, all spin interacts with each spin interacts with every other spin. Okay, okay. But in order to make it extensive, in order to make it looks additive, I have to rescale it by n, right? Because this goes like n squared, this term, right? Because every spin, all spins interact with each other with the same strength. And therefore, this energy goes like n squared. And so therefore, typically, one divides it by 2n. And this is kind of a Hamiltonian that one studies, you know, within this scheme, that you rescale the Hamiltonian with the volume, which in this case is just n. And here, it's a simple case in which basically sigma is minus d, that is, the interaction does not decay at all. It's a constant. But it's very small. You make the interaction constant very small. That is, you rescale j by 1 over n. And therefore, you still get something which is scale like V. Okay? Sorry? No, this could be anything. This in any dimension. The dimension here is not really important anymore. Yeah, because every spin interacts, it doesn't matter. The geometry is not there anymore. So on the face of it, it looks that when you do this, you solved your problem, right? Because this scales like V. And if it scales like V, then V and S are comparable, and everything is OK. But that's not true, because although this Hamiltonian is what's called extensive, namely, I scale the system by n by something, then this is going to scale in the same way, scale like n, it's not additive. And that's what I want to stress. It is still not additive, and it has a lot of features that I'm going to discuss. In what sense it's not additive? Take, for example, this Ising model. What does it mean, additive? Additive means that I take one system and another system, put them together, and the energy should be just the sum of the two energies. Okay? So suppose we take a system of these spins, and suppose that I make half of the spins up, this is one system, and half of the spin down. Okay? So I have altogether n spins, and I have n over 2 here spins which are up, and n over 2 which are down. Okay? Now, what is the energy of the system? The energy is this. Now, sum over sigma is 0, because, okay, so the energy, the total energy, is clearly 0. Now, but let's look now, let's separate the two halves and look at the energy of each one of them. Okay? Now, the energy of the up spins is one is minus j over n. N now is n over 2, but there is a 2n here because I have n over 2, times n over 2 squared. OK? So it's minus jn over 4. And similarly, the energy of this part is minus jn over 4. And therefore, E, which is 0, is not E plus E minus. So although you rescale the energy in this way, you don't have this simple notion of additivity that you have in systems with short-range interactions, which are very important in handling the thermodynamic properties of these systems. Okay? So what I want to do now is to tell you what is the consequence, what could be the consequences of such non-additivity. Okay? Because this is the central issue of this kind of systems, that they are not additive. That is, I put two systems next to each other, their energy is not adding up. There is the surface. Usually, you have a surface energy in systems with short-range interactions, which is negligibly small. Here, the surface energy, what's called quotation mark, because every spin interacts with every other spin, no matter, even if it decays, but it decays like 1 over r plus to the d plus sigma, and sigma is negative, still, this surface energy is not negligible, and the system is not additive. Okay, is that clear? Sorry, I don't hear.
Even short-range systems do not be 100% additive.
Well, they are additive in the thermodynamic limit. That is, when the energy is volume-like plus surface-like. So the surface, so when you add two systems, there is a surface term, but the surface term is negligibly small. Here, the surface term scales like the volume, and therefore you cannot neglect it. That's the difference. And therefore, you have to deal with it in the in the thermodynamic limit. OK. What are the consequences of non-additivity? Okay. Typically, okay. So I want to deal with consequences. Okay. Okay. Suppose, let's go back to systems with short-range interactions. Okay? Basically, it's you look at entropy, you define entropy, and you want to draw entropy as a function of energy, right? The very first beginning of statistical physics course. Then what you learn is that if you have a curve, the curve should be concave, right? It's all, this is OK? You all know what I'm talking about. OK. Namely, that if you have a curve which looks like that, this is not an acceptable curve for entropy versus energy, right? Because it should have been something like that. It should always be concave. You cannot have a dip like that where the second derivative is positive of the entropy versus the energy. Why is that? The reason in systems with short-range interaction is that the following. Suppose I have a system with this energy E0 here, somewhere in the domain, where in the region of energies where the entropy is not concave, is convex. Then what I can do is the following. I can say, look at a point here. I can, you know, put a tangent and look at a point here, call it E1 and E2. And I can do the following exercise. I can split the system into two subsystems, one with energy E1, the other one with energy E2. And I will make the relative weight of these two subsystems to be such that the total energy is E0. Okay? In that case, okay, when I do that, the entropy of the resulting system, because of additivity, is going to be here, right? Because I have a system whose entropy is here if the energy is E2. Here, the entropy is that. And I just take weighted average between the two. Okay? So I can gain entropy by splitting the system into two subsystems with different energies, and they coexist. And therefore, the entropy has to be concave. Otherwise, you can do this, and you get a splitting. And so basically, in a usual case, if you somehow get a curve like that, you can replace it easily by this curve, where this and that here, straight line, and that, and this is a concave function. Okay, and that's usually what happens when you have a phase transition or coexistence in systems with short-range interactions. Okay, the main thing we used here is additivity, right? Because we split the system, we said, and the energy is just sum of the two energies of the two systems. Now, in systems like that, this is not true. They are not additive in this sense, that I cannot just put two systems and say that their energy is the sum of the two. And therefore, it's not clear at all that if I just do this exercise and split the system into two, that I will end up with an entropy which is like that. Okay? So in principle, a system can still follow this curve and it will be perfectly happy. Okay? So this is a big difference between this can never happen in systems with short-range interactions. So one of the consequences of non-additivity is that you can have an entropy curve which is non-concave. Okay? Sorry. This argument. Okay? Again. I started with a system with energy E0. Okay? And now I said, okay, this is the system. It's energy E0. Now I said I split it into two subsystems. Okay, if you want, I have to be more careful. It's E0 over n. N is the total number of particles, the energy per unit particle. So here I have an energy, I split it. Here I have an energy E1 over N1. I take N1 particles, put them here, and I take N2 particles, put them there. So here I have the energy per particle E2 over N2. Okay? And I choose N1 and N2 such that the total energy is still E0. So it's the same energy. So I have here a system of N1 particles whose energy per particle is E1. So their entropy is that. Here I have a system with N, and here I have a system of N2 particles with energy E2. So therefore, their entropy is that. And therefore, the entropy of the two systems is, because of additivity, and the entropy is also an additive quantity, it's just the sum of the two entropies of the two systems, you know, the weighted average. And this is just on that line. And therefore, the entropy of this system is here, which is higher than the entropy of the homogeneous system. And therefore, the system will split spontaneously. Right? This is the usual argument, which does not hold here anymore. This is the basic stability of systems with short-range interactions.
So I can extrapolate this curve and join it by this treatment?
Sorry?
In case of systems where additivity holds,
yes.
I can
Right. So basically, the entropy curve will be you end up with an entropy curve will be this way. Now this straight line, and then here. This will be the entropy curve rather than this one. And this is a concave function, and it's stable, and everything is OK. 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 What does it mean? It means that the fact that it's non-concave is that you can have a specific heat. The specific heat of the system could be negative. Cv is negative, could be negative. Why? Because Cv is, you know, 1 over the temperature is just dS dE, right? This is 1 of the temperature. And now I take derivative of that with respect to E, so it's minus 1 over, no, that's not a good. So minus 1 over t squared dt dE is just d2s dE squared, right? And therefore, this is 1 over cv, right? This is just dE dt is cv. So dE dt is 1 over cv. And therefore, cv is just minus 1 over t squared d2s dE squared, right? And if in a system with long-range interactions I follow this curve, here the second derivative of d2s dE squared is positive, and cv is negative, right? Which is strange. You add the heat to the system, and it cools down. But it's okay. That's okay. So such systems can have negative specific heat in principle. I didn't show you that, I didn't demonstrate that they follow this curve. I'll do that later, and they don't always follow that curve. But because there is no additivity, I just don't have the argument that they have to split. That's all I'm saying. And all kinds of things can happen. In particular, one scenario is just they keep on following that curve. I'll show that in certain cases later on. Okay, and you can have negative specific heat. Now, this is the definition of specific heat. Okay, when you do it in a canonical, in the microcanonical ensemble, right? You have a system with energy E. You have the entropy of that system. And then you just do the derivatives, and you get the specific heat. On the other hand, if you look at okay, so this is what's called microcanonical ensemble. You can do a canonical approach, right, to the same for the same system. Now, in a canonical approach, you know, the energy is just trace of h e to the minus beta h, right? Beta is 1 over the temperature over trace of e to the minus beta h, right? That's how you define the energy, where beta is 1 over k Boltzmann t. Right? That's how it's the average of the energy. Now, if you look at dE dt, which is CV, you have just to take the derivative of this beta with respect, you know, this thing with respect to beta. And you end up with, this is just 1 over t squared, the average of h squared minus average of h squared. You can easily see that. Average squared. So basically, the specific heat is just given by the fluctuations of the energy, right? But this is always positive. Okay? So if you take a system like that, and you calculate it, you calculate whatever thermodynamic properties you want in a microcanonical ensemble, you can get something like that with negative specific heat. On the other hand, if you do the calculation in a canonical ensemble, well, that's the definition of specific heat. It's always positive. And therefore, the ensembles are not equivalent. So you have to be very careful what do you do when you do some calculations. Usually we are used to the notion that all ensembles are equivalent, doesn't matter what you do. Just do the calculation, use the easiest possible way, use the ensemble that makes it most convenient, and you get the thermodynamic functions, and that's it. They all should give you the same result. Here it's not true. And you have to be careful. You have to know what you're doing and what you're looking for. And okay? Yeah. I cannot hear you.
The last equation you wrote, left hand side is d in dt.
This one?
Yes,
yes,
this one.
Yes?
Left hand side is d in dt and right hand side is energy squared by d squared.
This is the average of energy squared minus the average of energy squared.
So this is the right hand side is energy squared by t squared.
This is CV, right? And this is always positive, right? Because it's just fluctuations of, they're always positive. That's a general theorem. What's the question?
His objection is about the dimensions. If you look at dimensions on the left, it is energy by temperature.
Right.
On the right, it is energy squared divided by temperature.
Right. Why? Well, there's a K Boltzmann, you know, it's just energy over K, you know. It's energy over, you know, temperature is energy, and this is energy square, so this is dimensionless, and this is dimensionless. Everything is okay. Okay? Yeah. Yeah. Okay. Okay. So ensembles are inequivalent. Okay, so the first thing that we notice without really doing anything, that we don't expect ensembles when you deal with these systems, even after we rescale them, we rescale the energy so that they look extensive, they are different from the usual things that that we have. We can have negative specific heat, for example, and we can and ensembles need not be equivalent. It's not to say that they are always not equivalent. You can have systems with short, with long range interactions that in some parameter space you get the same result whatever you do, but it's not guaranteed, and in many cases they are not equivalent, and then you have to do other things. Okay. So you have to look at the system. For example, if you look at this notion, system of globular clusters, these are isolated system, and the very natural way to calculate things is to look at the microcanonical ensemble, right? It's an isolated system. There is no, it's not coupled to a heat bath. And you can study what happens there using the microcanonical ensemble. I'll mention a few things about it later on.
The two ensembles gave different answers.
Right.
So which is more correct?
Which is?
Which is more appropriate? Does it depend on the system or is it always microcanonical?
It's not always true. I'll talk about it later on. But all I say is, for example, in these isolated clusters, you know, the natural thing to do is to look at the microcanonical ensemble because it's isolated, not coupled to anything. It's not always the case, and we have to, each case you have to treat differently.
And the ensembles don't agree because relativity fails, is that the central reason?
I can't. I'm sorry.
The ensembles not agree because it's not additive?
Right. They don't agree because it's not additive. That's the main point I want to stress. And even if you do this rescaling, still they are not additive. And okay. And you should remember, this rescaling is basically looking at the system at, you know, finite system, high temperature limit. You know, it mimics that, what I said before.
So in this kind of system, one cannot go from one to another by saddle
point. Saddle point. Yeah, it depends. Yeah, you have each ensemble you have to do. Yes. You're right. Well, if saddle point doesn't exist, if you do, that's true. That's true. Okay. It's okay. I'm not sure I understand what you mean by that. By saddle, then that's not true. Okay, that's not, right, that's not true. Right, absolutely, yes.
So, in the example of the globular cluster,
right.
Are you assuming a single temperature for this
entire system? Just, yeah, for example, yes, just for simplicity to, of course, you know, it's a whole body of work. I'm not going to enter into that, into the specifics of global clusters and astro, you know, gravitational systems. Okay, I'll say something about it later on, but okay. Okay, so this is just to set the stage of what I'm kind of problems I want to discuss. Okay, but there is more to it. In a sense, when we look at interactions V of R, which are and we were looking at sigma negative. That's what I call negative or zero. What I call strong long-range interactions. Suppose now we look at sigma is positive. When sigma is positive, then system is additive. That is, and therefore, all the, you know, since the basic assumption of statistical physics, hold, it's additive, then, you know, ensembles are equivalent, everything is okay. We can use the tools that we learned in statistical physics to treat such systems. But still, if sigma is larger than zero, but not very large, means that the decay is not fast, but the decay is, you know, a little bit more than the dimension, faster than the dimension. Still, there is this kind of algebraic interactions affect the behavior of the system. Particularly, they affect phase diagrams, they affect phase transitions, they can affect the what's called the critical behavior of a system. Okay? You learned about phase transitions and critical behavior, right, of systems, right? So when sigma is positive, you can use all the tools of statistical physics, it's okay, but you are going to have, if sigma is not too large, the effect of this long-range interaction is going to show up in the thermodynamic behavior. So they are not like short-range interactions. In systems with short-range interactions, say, if I take system with exponentially decaying interaction, or nearest neighbor and next nearest neighbor and whatever, if I look at phase transitions are not going to be the thermodynamic behavior, or critical behavior, is not going to be affected by the precise nature of the interaction, whether it's nearest neighbor or next nearest neighbor or exponential or fast decaying exponential or slow decaying exponential. They're all going to give you the same critical behavior, same thermodynamic behavior near a phase transition. On the other hand, if the interaction goes this way, that's not true. It's going to depend on the sigma. It's going to depend on things. So let me just draw you a phase diagram. Rough phase diagram of a system that interacts with this kind of interaction, and sigma is positive. Oh, well, sigma general, not only positive. And let me just say what is expected. Okay, here is sigma, and here is the dimension of the system. Here, the dimension is 1, dimension 2, dimension 3, 4, 5, and sigma is 1, 2, etc., and this is negative, minus 1, minus 2, etc. Okay, we have seen that if sigma is negative, particularly, okay, if sigma is negative but it's larger than d, so that sigma plus d is, I want a decaying potential, so this is the region. This is what I called strong long range. Right? This is the region I talked about now. Okay? What happens when sigma is positive? It turns out, let me draw, okay, the line 4, 2. And there is a line here, which nobody won't, you know, how to calculate. I don't know. Okay. The the graph says the following. In this region, the mean field critical behavior. That is, if we talk about phase transitions in systems with sigma positive, if the dimension is sufficiently large or sigma is sufficiently large, particularly if the dimension is above 4, you have you know that you have, when you look at phase transitions, you have critical behavior, and above 4 dimension, you get critical exponents or critical behavior, which is given by the mean field approximate. Who doesn't know what I'm talking about? Everybody know?
I don't know. You were now discussing about critical behavior or liquid gas transitions?
Of, for example, or magnets or whatever.
The pair potential.
Right.
So it means particle systems, and you also discuss the critical behavior.
Right.
So it means that you discuss the critical home.
Right. Absolutely. Absolutely. I'm saying for these systems where sigma is, you can think of magnets, which spin magnets with interactions that goes like 1 over r to the d plus sigma.
Oh.
For example, think of Ising model.
This case is also covers a phenomenon induction case.
Yes, yes. Yes.
You can obtain the same diagram. You can obtain the same diagram for two cases of critical behaviors of a liquid gas critical.
Yeah. And you ask, what is the critical behavior? And it turns out that the critical behavior depends on the dimension and depends on sigma. And if the dimension is sufficiently large, particularly if it's larger than 4, you get critical behavior of mean field, what you get from the mean field. I discuss it later on, but I just want to give you a hint. And also here, in this region, if sigma is sufficiently small, this mean field behavior goes this way. On the other hand, here, when sigma is sufficiently large, this is the short range. Critical behavior. If sigma is large, for example, here, but if sigma is, say, here, you know, then it's valid here.
If sigma is equal to d, then it's valid below d equal to 4?
Yes. If sigma, say sigma is 1, it's valid even here. Yes. You see, sigma gives you long-range interactions, right? The smaller... the smaller the sigma, the longer range the system is, the interaction is, right? And long range interactions favors mean field kind of behavior. That's what it says. Here, if sigma is roughly above 2, this line starts with 2, but it's curved and it's about this. If it's here, then the critical behavior is that of short range. It's as if it's really short-range interactions, like you have nearest neighbor or exponential decay or whatever. Here, in this region, you get a different exponent, which are long-range exponent behavior. And the line separating the long and short is a bit curved, and that's why I was reading this way. It's curved. So you have the sigma, the fact that you have interaction that decays slowly enough with the distance gives you different critical exponents in a region like that. So if sigma is sufficiently small, not large, for a given d, if it's sufficiently small, it's still okay. Okay, so that's roughly to give you that, to tell you, I'll talk about it. I may devote some time to it later on when sigma is positive, you still have the effect of long-range interactions. But this is what I called weak long-range interactions. Okay? It's weak because ensembles are equivalent, specific heat is positive, everything is okay, you can use the usual tools of statistical mechanics, but you are going to end up with different behavior if you look at critical behavior or things like that. Of course, at sufficiently low dimension, there is no longer an order at all, you know, in one dimension, and okay. So, but you have to look at this only here. Okay? That's clear. Okay. Sorry? The
long range part, it starts after 4, right? D equals 4, you get mean field.
Yes, right. Yeah, D beyond, you mean here?
Yeah, beyond D equals 4.
Beyond, in that direction?
Regardless of how small your sigma is.
Right, right. The D takes care of it. The fact that you have your many nearest neighbors already takes care of the exponents and give you the critical behavior. Here, only for small sigma, you can get, if small enough sigma, you can still get the critical behavior even in lower dimensions. That's the point. Because, you know, the fact that you have long-range interactions effectively increases the dimension of the system. You can think about it this way. So the mean field is extend the region in which you can have mean field. And also, if you go in this direction, you can still have an intermediate region where the behavior, the critical behavior, is neither the short range nor the mean field, but something else, which is specific to long range interactions. Okay.
So, long range exponents depends on the value of sigma?
Yes.
And can you calculate it, these values, or just a numerical mean?
Or you can do renormalization group, you know, epsilon expansion. You can expand around the critical dimension. For example, you see here it says that if you take, say, sigma is equal to 1, and you there is a critical dimension associated with that, and above which it is mean field, below which it is not. And you can make epsilon expansion around, for example, this point. Around the right point and get into the right. Right.
So it's quite difficult to have some information about the shorter range critical behavior. So, you know, this is one of doing to obtain the exponent of the short range critical.
Right, but this you do here.
Yeah,
I mean,
it's quite difficult.
But the guy coming from this way, no, that's not, no. Okay, also this line is okay, this is just a straight line. This line is very difficult to calculate, the separation between where the long-range exponents are valid or the short-range exponents are valid. All you know, it comes here and the one can calculate the behavior here, but there's a line.
Okay.
So I hope I gave you some general picture of what I'm going to, what is the subject I'm going to talk about. And let me just give you a very brief outline, just so that we can, in the next few days, follow it. So it's a very brief outline. And very schematic. I want to first devote some time to strong, what I call strong long-range interactions. Okay? Okay, these are non-additive. And I want to talk about consequences of non-additivity. What I'll do, I'll show you some models, simple models, in which you can actually calculate things. and calculate, say, negative specific heat, CV negative, inequivalence of ensembles, then there is similar things between, of course, inequivalence of canonical ensemble and grand canonical ensemble, right? I talked about microcanonical and canonical, right? But same thing as, you know, you are going to have, if you look at systems with chemical potentials, and so the two ensembles will not be equivalent. I will then make a comment on self-gravitating systems. Comment. Okay, in self-gravitating systems, one of the, usually when I say that the interaction goes like that, this is the behavior at large distances. I did not mean that at short distances it goes to infinity, right? It's not, you know, there is a cutoff usually. But if you just take pure gravitational systems, then there is a, you know, the large distance behavior, which is 1 over r to the d plus sigma, which is this thing I'm talking about. But there is also, there is a, you know, in gravitations, they can collapse, right? Because the energy, they attract each other, and the energy goes to minus infinity. And there are all kinds of problems that arise from the short distance behavior, right? If you don't make a cutoff. So there are some problems like that. I will want to discuss it. Then, so this is, I want to talk about, this is the thermodynamics, right? Then there is some dynamical aspects, which I want to discuss, which is, one of them is slow relaxation. These systems are characterized by very slow relaxation. You see, if system is interacting with and very long range, it's very difficult to change things. And therefore, they relax very slowly. They relax so slowly that in certain cases, they generate what's called quasi-stationary states. That is, you have a stationary state, which is not Boltzmann-like, that that decays to the Boltzmann distribution eventually on a time scale which grows with the system size. So it doesn't decay on a finite time to the true equilibrium state, but it decays on a time scale which is divergent with the system size. Therefore, if you are in the thermodynamic limit, where the system size is very large, infinite, then it's just stable. You can have stable states which are not Boltzmann-like. So I want to discuss this notion of slow relaxation and what you know about it. And also, there is also ergodicity breaking. That is, these systems with long-range interactions are prone to ergodicity breaking. That is, they move in some phase space, and they somehow cannot reach other parts of the phase space because of these long-range interactions. I'll discuss it later on. So basically, this is what I want to talk about, strong long-range interactions. Then I want to devote at least one talk to systems with weak long-range interactions. Long-range interactions. So here I want to discuss basically this kind of critical behavior and the critical dimension upper critical dimension. I will discuss this for systems with weak long-range interactions. Then, I will do it very briefly. I want to talk about mixed-order phase transitions. In cases of these weak long-range interactions, you can have what's called mixed-order phase transition. That is, phase transitions which have features of both first order and second order. Typically, you know, phase transitions are, you know, you classify into first order or second order. In the second order phase transitions, you have a correlation length which diverges, and you have an order parameter which goes to zero continuously at the transition, like in a magnet. Like if you have a magnet, right, and magnetization as a function of temperature, you get something like that. So the magnetization goes to zero continuously at the transition. At the same time, you have infinite correlation length. Okay? This is second order. In a first order phase transition, you have a magnetization that drops discontinuously, m versus t. It drops discontinuously, but there is no infinite correlation length. There is no divergence of correlation. Now, mixed order phase transitions have feature of both. They have this continuous order parameter, but infinite correlation length. And they can show up in some systems with this kind of long-range interactions. I will discuss it in more detail. And I will end up I want to talk about systems non-equilibrium. Or driven systems. You know that in such systems which are not in thermal equilibrium, that systems that reach a steady state, but it's not a thermal equilibrium because there are currents or, you know, it is rather generic that they have long-range correlations. Okay, one cannot talk about interactions here because they are driven, but they have long-range correlations. That is, I perturb the system someplace, I can feel the perturbation very far away. So in some sense, this is very similar to what happens in equilibrium when you have long-range interactions. So I want to make a contact between these two features, the long-range correlations that appear in long-range correlations. Okay? That appear here. And I want to make a contact between this and properties of systems in equilibrium, but with long-range interactions. Okay? So I want to, and here, okay, so I don't know how much I will be able to cover, but basically, that's what I want to do in the course. Okay? Any questions or so far? Okay. Okay. Good. Okay, so let's go to the beginning here. And what I want to do is to look at a very simple model of a system which has long-range interactions and study it. Study it both in a canonical ensemble and in a microcanonical ensemble, and see what we can expect to have when we do this, when we do that, and what's the difference between the two. Okay? That's the. Okay. Okay. By the way, many of the things that I say that you can find in a Lesouche lecture note. And it appears in archive. Okay. Okay. So I want to define a model. So I want, the model is the following, simple model. The model is the following. It's a one-dimensional Ising model with long and short range interactions. Okay? Okay. And I'll justify, I'll motivate why this model and why. Okay. So here's the Hamiltonian. Is minus j over 2n sum over sigma I squared. I goes from 1 to n. So this is a long range interaction. Sigma I is just plus minus 1. But I want to also add k over 2 sum over sigma I plus 1. Okay? So there is long range interactions, as we said before. It's kind of mean field interactions. Every spin interacts with every other spin. But there is also short range interaction of nearest neighbor. Okay? Okay. Now, what do we expect for this model? And I want to look at this model and study it in a canonical and in a microcanonical ensemble. Okay. Let's look at the ground state. Okay, that's, you see, when you get a model, first thing you do is you look at the ground state to see what are kind of structures you have. And then maybe look at high temperature and then see, try to see what you can guess from what's happened, or from what, from these two limits. Sorry?
Is it?
Ah, it doesn't really matter. It doesn't matter. Periodic or, that's not the issue here. It's short range, so it's not. You see, for this part, it doesn't really matter anyway, right? And for this part, it's nearest neighbor, it's not that important. In the thermodynamic limit, it's not important anyway. Okay, and I'm going to take this model with J positive. That is, it's a ferromagnetic nearest neighbor, long range interaction. But K could be either positive or negative, which is ferromagnetic or antiferromagnetic. Okay, what is the ground state? Okay. Okay, the ground state as a function of k over j. So suppose k over j is 0 here, and it's, what could be the ground state? I'll just draw it. It's minus 1/2. If k over j is minus 1/2, so in this region, it is antiferromagnetic. And above minus 1/2, it is ferromagnetic. Okay? This is the ground state. Okay. To see that, it's trivial. You just write down the energy. Because these are the only two possible, you know, ground states that you can have. You know, because this term favors ferromagnetic ordering. This one, if k is negative, if k is positive, it also favors ferromagnetic, and then there's no question about it. That's why it's positive here. It's all ferromagnetic. But if k is negative, it favors antiferromagnetic ordering. So therefore, these are the two possible orders that you can think of. And if you look at the energy, the E of the ferromagnetic, just put it there, is minus J N over 2 minus K N over 2, right? That's put all spins equal that. And E antiferromagnet. For E antiferromagnet, these terms contribute 0, and this one contributes K N over 2. Right? Minus K N over 2. No, plus K N over 2. Right. OK? And when you compare these two, you see that if K is negative, as you expect, but it's less than 1/2, lens minus 1/2. It's antiferromagnetic. If it's above, it's ferromagnetic, as you expect. Now, what happens if, say, K is positive? It favors magnetic ordering. And therefore, if I try to plot a phase diagram, I would guess the following, just a guess. OK, the phase diagram looks like that. This is minus 1/2. This is K over J. And this is T over J. OK, so here, in this region, I expect to have a phase transition from zero magnetization to non-zero magnetization, ferromagnetic order, right? Yeah, OK? Because there should be a phase transition, because it's as if, this favors, this is the usual Ising model with some ferromagnetic interaction. There is going to be a phase transition at some temperature. Now, OK, so there is this line here. Now, what happens here? Here, as I said, here it's antiferromagnetic. And here it's ferromagnetic. Now, these are two different orders. And therefore, if I go to finite temperature, what I would expect is to have kind of first order phase transition separating them. Because these are two different orders of two different symmetries. And I don't see this goes continuously into that in a way. So I expect, that's what I would expect, a first order phase transition there. On the other hand, here, I expect a second order phase transition, usual Ising-like phase transition. And therefore, a phase diagram, if I just, I extrapolate, I would expect something like that. A first order phase transition here, a tricritical point here, and a line like that. So this is second order or critical line or second order. Here it's a first order. And this one is what is called tricritical point. It's a point separating first order from second order line. That's what I would expect. Now, I just want to, so that you get familiar with the model, can you tell me, why don't I expect the plus minus phase, the antiferromagnetic phase, to extend? OK, here m is 0 in this region. M is 0 all over, and m is not equal to 0 there. There is a ferromagnetic transition. Why don't you expect antiferromagnetic order here? Because like here, you have a ferromagnetic order at 0 temperature. You increase the temperature a little bit. You have a ferromagnetic order, right? You don't destroy it. Here, what happens is you have antiferromagnetic order at 0 temperature. You go to finite temperature. No matter how low, you destroy order altogether. Do you understand that just by looking at this model? Sorry?
Because
this is a one-dimensional model, and therefore this term that favors the antiferromagnetic order doesn't support a phase transition in one dimension, okay? The only term that can support order is this one. And this one supports only the ferromagnetic order. It doesn't support the antiferromagnetic order, and therefore that's the phase diagram that you would expect. Okay. What's the time now? Oh. Okay. So what I want to do next time is just solve this model in a canonical ensemble, solve it in the microcanonical ensemble, show you get very different phase diagrams, show you how you get negative specific heats and how things combine together when you do that. Okay? Okay.